I want to quickly tell you a small story about myself. I was born in a village of about 2,000 people. The roads of the villages around my, even including my annual pay. I remember that I lived with my grandparents, especially my grandmother, from my maternal side. I would go to school as a primary school student, and when I come back from school, I would go and sell stuff to make sure that we can eat properly. I would sell pap, which we call agidi. I would sell kerosene and a couple of other things. But I was lucky that my parents and my grandparents found it very essential for me to go to school. And they did everything that they had in their power to ensure that I went to the best of schools. As a young student in the University of Learning, I remember when I was in part two, we had an excursion that we had to do to somewhere called Old Oyo National Park, somewhere here in Oyo State. I saw a young man, a young boy, I want to call him Adebayo. As we were driving out of a town called Secretary, very close to Shein.
Secretary.
Oh, it's Secretary. There was this young boy who was running from his helmet, and he was running towards the roadside. And I was wondering in my mind that, why is he running? What is he looking for? So the driver of the bus that we took told me that for the last 3 years that he has been plying this road, every time he drove by, he has seen that boy run from that old village to the main road, just so he can see the type of vehicle that was moving on that road. That was 17 years ago. Today, Nigeria has the highest number of children out of schools. Anywhere in the world, we take the number one spot. And we've run a democratically elected government over the last, say, 18 years or thereabouts. During my own time, it was a military government, so I can understand that, okay, maybe things were a bit different. But we try to say that democracy is a representative governance, where the people matter. But here we are, after we have run a democratically elected government system for the last 18 years, we are still where we used to be about 30, 35 years ago, if we are not worse off. I know this slide. The truth of the matter is, we as a people, we think that we matter in this country, but the truth is we do not matter that much. And I'll tell you why. Everybody has been going about shouting, go and collect your PVC, go and register for PVC, collect your PVC, we're waiting for next year February, we're going to vote. Have you asked yourself this honest question? Who are you going to vote for? Do you know the process by which who you are voting for emerge? Are these the type of candidates that you would honestly want them to represent you? My honest answer to you is, your vote doesn't count so much. I'm not saying that voting on election day is not important, but there's something that is much more important than voting on election days. There's a process that brings out those who are on the ballot boxes that you are going to vote for. We run a system where we do not vote for candidates, we vote for political party system. I have never seen where Bisi Ogunwale is written on the ballot paper or Stanley Nam is written on ballot paper. Is it that APC, AGC, SDP, NRC, or whatever name they call themselves? Growing up as a young person, I found this early in my life to know that the only way we can seriously change things is for us to be able to change the type of governance that we run in this country and in the entire of Africa, if I must say. Why is this important that we must get this done? Number one, you have a system where you don't know how the candidate emerged, but you have your voter's card and you keep saying that it is only on election days that the powerful and the less powerful are equal. It is not true. Yes, on the election day, everybody will queue in the sun, in the rain to cast the vote. But some people have already decided your fate before you got to that ballot boxes to cast your vote, because they've decided who the candidate is going to be. And that's where the corruption starts. The people who control the political parties are the most powerful set of people in any democracy. And that's why I say young people of Nigeria must unite to defend this democracy. I have told my story. I have told you the story of this young boy. I've also tried to paint to you what the reality in Nigeria is currently. A couple of weeks ago, about 10 days actually, I wrote an article in Cable, and this was, you know, like a pictography of what it is. Every year, over 600,000 people get into university through JAMB. Only about 26% of people who write JAMB every year are able to get placement in the university, polytechnic, or colleges of education. Why? We don't have the carrying capacity. Every year we graduate about 500,000 people. But guess what? Just only a fraction of those are able to find job after. We keep dying needlessly and senselessly because we cannot provide quality healthcare for ourselves. Why? Because of the set of people that you put in power. Because of the kind of people who are controlling the affairs of the country. They can afford to fly themselves out of the country to go and have the best of healthcare. They can take their children to anywhere to go to school. Can you and I do that? So, my question to you is, they've told you that you should go and get your PVC, you've gotten your PVC, you are waiting for the sun to bite you and for the rain to beat you just because you want to vote for one candidate or the other. I'm very certain that you don't even know the candidates that you are voting for. Some of them you've never heard their names before. But here is the thing. Is it possible for us to have the kind of government that we want? My answer is yes. But in speaking to a lot of people, I have come to realize that people have given up the hope that things can be better, especially the political system. It is not so. The power lies in each and every one of us sitting here today. And that's why I think it's important for us to have this question. Yes, your vote is very important. But right in there, you have a small fraction of life. Your vote is not that important. This is how I define the way democracy is currently in. Is the freedom to elect our own dictators. That's the way it works. They basically tell you what they want to tell you, not what you want them to do. Politicians don't look for you. You are the ones that are looking for politicians. That's the way, you know, we run in this part of the country. And this is a very good tweet that I like to always, you know, we live in a representative democracy where the elected officers are accountable to the people. There is nothing bigger than any April Fool that is. This is the biggest joke that is told on us. Now, I believe that we must build, We like to believe that the fate of a government lies in the hands of the citizens. This view is very wrong. But put it simply, political parties are the democratic gatekeepers. Do you know what gatekeepers are? Yeah. These guys just basically shut every one of us out of the system, and they are the one controlling the show. They decide what goes and what comes. That gatekeeping property, or that gatekeeping duty, is what you and I need to get into. We need to build right political party system in the country. And there are a couple of ways we can go about it. And I'm not saying this is the only way we can go about it, but I'm saying this is what I have, you know, personally been able to find. As a matter of fact, I must tell you that because of the things that I've seen, I decided to go into the political system. I ran for an election during the last election, even though I didn't win. But I came back out of that process with so much information that I think that the people need to know, even though they don't want me to speak about them. But I think it's important that young people of this country begin to see the realities of the things that we're, you know, running against. Please, let's move forward. there is no political party in this country. What we have is an association of men and women who are just basically catering for their individual selfish interests and pockets. Nobody has come together to define the ideology of any political party in this country. There is no principle, no ideals, no characteristics, nothing that defines what a political party is. So today I can be in SDP, tomorrow I can be in DTC, and the next day I can go to PDP or wherever I want to be. It doesn't change anything. A typical Nigerian politician does not see the wrong in the fact that he cannot identify him or herself with one particular thing. This is where the fundamental problem lies. We need to begin to find what would be ideal situation for a political system to run. There is nothing like constitution in political parties. Yes, there are documents that they call constitution. But today, one rule applies, tomorrow another one changes. Why? The person that controls the party decides what he or she wants to do at any point in time, and that is what the constitution is. That piece of paper that is written as the constitution of the party doesn't really count for nothing. And that's a shame. Because we all sit down and begin to tweet, write on Facebook, abusing ourselves, fighting ourselves because of this set of people, without realizing the fact that these are the same set of human beings that are putting you and I where we are. Please. How do we begin to talk about membership of political parties? A lot of people have come to me to ask, how did you even become a member of a political party? That's one of the things that parties in this country should be shameful about. Nobody even knows how to join political parties. You can't find any information around, I want to join party A, party B, or party C. You don't know how to go about them. No party has come out to say, this is what we want to do. I mean, some of them recently said they did new members registration. Ask them, where is the database of your membership? Can you show me register of your members? Yes, there are registers, let's be honest with ourselves. But it's not for people like you and I to see. It's for the owners of the party to hold. That's where the problem is. We need to liberalize this process. Let everybody be able to go on the internet on this particular party's website and say, I want to know when Bisi Omwale joined this party. What is his party number? Where is his party ward? If we have that kind of system, accountability will come into the process. And then we kind of talk about the financing. Imagine a party says they are registered 15.6 million members. What is the use of these members? What are they doing in the party? In each every one of us houses, we have something that is called DSTV, don't we? Everybody pays subscription on a monthly basis to watch, you know, that stuff. Can party system not organize in such a way that we would have subscription-based party membership situation, such that every member pays one fee or the other to become a member of this particular party? You know why they won't do it? Because the moment they allow you to be a financial member of the party, then they become answerable to you. They don't want your money because they don't want you to be part of the decision-making process. They want to be able to take decision and foster it on you. Again, we need to come back to see how do we begin to talk about financing our political party? How do we fund political party? And then moving from there, we want to ask ourselves, what is this decision-making process of a political party? Is it that some people will just come, sit down somewhere, Baba Sope, this is what we are going to do, and then they will take it to the general, this is what we have decided, just go and communicate it to them? Or an executive committee of members who are independent on their own will come and people will negotiate power. And then we will continue like that. How do we select candidates? This is the biggest fraud that we commit in this country. Let me tell you the way it works. There are two major ways for you to select party candidates. Either a direct or an indirect selection process. And I'll try to explain both of them. A direct process says that every financial member of a political party has a right, a vote, to determine who will represent him or her in the coming election. So in a direct primary system, everybody that is an aspirant will come, as I'm standing here, to speak to a general audience who are political party members. Vote for me, these are my programs. Vote for me, these are my programs. Vote for me, these are my programs. And people will vote on those bases. That's the direct process. The indirect process is, all of us here as party members, we will decide to elect or select some people to say, you know, we have delegated you to go and be our representative in the selection process. So you will foster your own rights as proxy to another person to go and vote on your behalf. You know what that does? It opens up corruption that candidates will now start lobbying those delegates and then inducing them by buying their conscience to vote for him or her. That's the process that we run. And then the one that now happens here is, even the direct and indirect does not happen. Somebody has already decided that this is what we are going to do, this is the person we are pushing forward, just go and tell them, the delegate, that's the person you should vote for. That's the kind of system that we run here. And that is the problem. And my problem is, everybody that I spoke to before I went into the political space, the ones that are older than me, let me say people in the ages of 45 and above, they will tell you that we do not see any other situation other than people getting involved in the political process. But you know, it's very difficult. It's not easy. I don't think you should do it, but if you must do it, it is the right thing to do. But when you talk to people of our own type of age, younger people between the ages of 35 below, they will tell you categorically, if you must do anything at all, please don't join politics. Why? Things are so difficult, the roads are bad, there's no water, healthcare is a problem, educational system is whatever it is. Let's be honest with ourselves. Government is in the right space to make the biggest of impact on a larger scale than any other person. Unless you are as rich as the Bill Gates of this world, you will never make the kind of impact that a government will make on a set of people. And the only way we can begin to make those impacts is by restructuring the political parties that form this government. The typical things that happen is, political parties write manifestos and on that basis begin to appeal to the people, sell their programs to the people and let people come to them to sign up as members, volunteers and all of that. But that doesn't happen here. Why? Because young people of today in Africa, especially in Nigeria, do not see the reason why you should be involved in the political process. As soon as you turn 18, it becomes a constitutional right for you to be able to get involved in the political process. But I have seen that people don't even care about it until maybe they turn 30, 35. Why? You've lost 17 years of your life that you can use to make good impact. Let's be honest with ourselves. I'm not asking that you should go and run for election. Not everybody would run for political offices, but everybody must be involved in the political process that would give us the right set of candidates and policies to be able to run a proper country. There's nothing in politics that happens by accident. Everything is planned. So don't let anybody deceive you with an idea of it would happen. It never happens by accident. Even if you think it's an accident, some people have decided that is the way they want it to be. Why don't you want to be part of the people who will be the people deciding this? There is no amount of reforms that we want. The guys who occupy this type of houses, you know what this is, right? This is the National Assembly of Nigeria. And then every state, the subnational governments have their own state House of Assembly, and the local governments have their own, you know, legislative councils too. Every person that goes into all these type of houses are the ones that determine the fate of you and I. But you and I don't have involvement in the process of how these people emerge. That's the problem. Parties are the best vehicle to sustain a set of beliefs. We will all die. But these political parties will be there so that they can continue to change ideas forever. Let me tell you something that I'm going to close with. Parties and their candidates that come forward for election are just like you are involved in a beauty pageant. The candidates that come up for election are not necessarily the people who are involved in the beauty pageant are not necessarily the most, for example, the most beautiful girl in Nigeria. They are not the most beautiful girl in Nigeria. The most beautiful girl in Nigeria is likely in somebody's house already as a wife. It's only the ones that come out to put themselves forward as the people that are involved in that pageantry that you are going to choose out from. That's the same way, you know, candidates and aspirants and political parties happen. I think, in all honesty, what we should more encourage to be involved in is how do we begin to get the right set of people into power so that some people will not be forming constituted authorities when they are not authorities. It is important for us to understand this. People have turned National Assembly into retirement homes for them.
Yeah.
Why? Because you and I have decided that we are not interested in politics. It is not cool. It is not, you know, for people like us. It's dirty. It's this. Do I look dirty? I am involved in the political process every day. I am just like you and I. I grew up in a place where many of you had better privileges than I am. But guess what? We will continue to suffer until we begin to think about what we're going to do. And this is where I'm going to close. Many of us in this room, and maybe the oldest person here among us today will be about 30 years old, right? We live in an age of great technological advancement where medical services have seen a lot of improvement. Barring any unforeseen circumstances and natural disasters, many of us in this room, we outlive so many of people that are leading us today. Do you want to inherit a country where you can carry on and do something reasonable with it? Or do you want to inherit a country that's already been bastardized that you cannot do anything about it? The question is for you to ask. Thank you so much.